You're watching The Robert Christian Show.
And good day, ladies and gentlemen. Robert Christian here, folks, with The Robert Christian Show. We have a good show, I think, folks, in tow today for everyone. And I hope that everybody today gets something out of today's show. Ladies and gentlemen, this is absolutely a fantastic opportunity that we have been granted and given. Leo Laporte, I have been watching him since back in the days when he was on Screensavers. And I'm sure that if the walls could talk in that studio, they probably would. However, we are honored to have Leo Laporte with us today, folks. So, Leo, welcome to the Robert Christian Show.
Thank you, Robert. Nice to see you.
And hey, it's nice to see you too. Trust me, I've been watching you off and on for several years. Back in the day when you were having the shows back with Tech TV, and that was some of those shows were absolutely insane. Now, what actually, Leo, got you involved in what you do?
Well, I do. You know, there's two different kind of tracks. One is the broadcaster track, and I started doing that in college and college radio in the 70s and continued to pursue that even today. I still do a radio show. And then there's the tech enthusiast or tech journalist track, and I started doing that also in the late 70s. I was working at a radio station in San Jose in the heart of Silicon Valley, and it was hard not to, in 1977 and 78, kind of get the bug. You had Atari and Apple and IBM, and things were just exploding, and it was really a fun time. And so I did get the bug. I kind of got my first computer, started playing with that, started writing programs. Pretty quickly realized I couldn't afford to buy the hardware and software I wanted all the time. So I said, maybe if I write about this stuff, I can get stuff for review. So I started writing, I think my first article for Byte magazine was in 84 when the Mac came out. I wrote for InfoWorld in the early 80s. And so it was really two different careers because I was just a DJ and then later a talk show host. It wasn't until early 90s, 1991, when John C. Dvorak and I started doing a syndicated computer talk show that I finally got to merge my two interests, technology and broadcasting.
So you actually did talk radio at one time.
Oh, yeah. General news talk. You bet. I did it for a long time. I'm still doing a technology talk show, a syndicated show. But yeah, I was doing political talk. I really hated it. You know, and it was in the early when I started doing talk radio in 1987. You still could interview book authors and have kind of a quiet show. And in 1990 or 91, I think, my show got canceled and replaced by Rush Limbaugh, who had just started syndicating nationally.
Oh, wow.
And that's when fiery talk radio really started taking off. I guess there'd always been a strain of that, but it became the predominant form of talk radio, you know, fiery political talk radio. And I tried it a little while. I was working on KGO in San Francisco doing a computer talk show, but they asked me from time to time to fill in with on news talk. They were at the time the number one news talk station in San Francisco, big station, and I did it for a while, and it was so combative, and I would leave the show with a stomach ache. I said, you know, I'm going to stick with computers. It's a little less difficult.
Well, you know, I've been talking over the last year with different ones, and they keep saying, look, you know, you've just got to find your niche, right? Well, I sort of did, because it's not the first time, Leo, for me to be working and doing what I do, especially in news talk, you know, because I've been doing it for oh my God, if I told you how old I was, you could figure it out. But anyway, for several years, and I have, you know, I've always sort of looked back at that as my roots. But for you with doing a tech show, what actually promoted you to do that?
My love for technology, but also I always had a kind of subversive goal. You know, first in radio and later in tech and television, I wanted to kind of empower people to use technology so that I wanted to even the balance. You know, technology, it, of course, in the early days was heavily used by government and business, big business. And I wanted to give consumers a handle on how to use technology initially to protect themselves, but subsequently to, as technology developed, to find a voice for themselves. Technology is this wonderful democratizing influence. And just as you're doing, as I'm doing, we can make our own shows on the internet. People are writing their own books. They're publishing them themselves. They're writing their own blogs. Suddenly, everybody can have a voice. You don't have to go through the big gatekeepers that controlled media right up until the late 80s and early 90s. And so to me, that was so exciting. And I really, so my kind of secret intention was to teach people about technology to empower them.
Well, do you think that back in the day when technology was evolving, and I guess it still is to some degree, the internet, do you think that there are more and more folks these days that are paying attention to the internet, that are getting on it in record number? Because of technology becoming very simple.
You bet. Back in the day. You bet. Look at the iPad. Look at its uptake. And you know what? The current big story is mobile. The idea that you're always connected to the internet via your smartphone or tablet. That really changes everything. And in fact, it's very interesting. It's this mobile stuff snuck up on even what one would think would be the most advanced technology companies, Facebook and Google, and they're struggling a little bit. You saw Google's stock take a dive last week because they make about 40% less in mobile advertising than they do in desktop advertising. Facebook hasn't figured it out yet either. Most of the Facebook users are now using it on mobile, and Facebook can't figure out how to make money on mobile. So it's funny. This stuff is moving so fast now. But I really do think that the world is getting online, and for the most part, the world's getting online not through desktop computers but through mobile devices.
You know, I think so, too. One thing that I have noticed, though, and I've yet to exactly figure this one out, but when it comes to live stream or Ustream or any of those other streaming providers that like this one, for an example, people that are on mobile devices are not counted on the viewer count. You don't see them. They're just invisible to it. And that's kind of bizarre. But we get people from everywhere that watch the show, but of course not as many as what you have on your show.
Well, you know, actually that isn't true. We have a lot of downloads. 90% of our views still come from downloads. We've moved, you know, we built this big studio and we've really moved towards doing what you're doing, which is live streaming. Because I think it's easier for somebody on a mobile device to launch an app or go to a web page, on a desktop to go to a web page and watch something as it's happening, than it is to figure out how to subscribe and download and sync it to a device and all of that. So I've really promoted live, but it's still a very small part of our audience. It's, you know, if you were looking at it from a purely practical business point of view, you'd say I was crazy. I've spent more than $1 million last year building this studio for live production.
That is a tremendous undertaking.
Yeah, I mean, but I'm so I sometimes say I've doubled down, or I'm all in. I use the gambler's jargon. I'm all in on live because I think in the long run, that's the future. You know, I just bought a new TV. It has not only an internet connection, but it has a Wi-Fi, you know, hardwired and Wi-Fi connection. It has apps on it. I think that what that means is going forward, internet broadcasters will be able to be on the air in the same way as a big network or a cable channel is. You know, we'll be on peers with them. And so I want to be there when that happens, that, you know.
Here is a thought, and I'll ask you about it, and then I'm going to play like I have a whole list of questions. Actually, I've got four good ones.
Don't worry, I can talk for a long time.
So for the time being, I'll just kind of play like I've got a huge list of questions. I read a story about YouTube, actually, and come to find out, according to the story, that there are more people that use YouTube for their news and for their information, for their technology, than they do watch a major network television in the United States. What do you think of that?
Yeah, that kind of surprises me because, you know, it's odd, Robert, is that television viewership is also up. I thought that by now there had been this shift where television viewership would be going down and online viewership would be going up. They're both going up. So I guess we're spending more time just sitting in front of screens than ever before. It doesn't surprise me, though, that people get a lot of their information from YouTube. Whether that's the best place to get news, I don't know. But it's certainly the transition that's happening, you know.
Well, here is my playlist, a list of questions, right? Hey, I've always got to come prepared for something. I always have. Because I wanted to talk specifically today with you about social media. How would you tell someone to use social media so it would actually work for them?
Well, it depends. You know, if I'm going in 2 weeks, I'm going on a cruise, a Mac Mania cruise. I do this every year or so. There's a company, it used to be called Geek Cruises, now they're called Insight Cruises, where they put these cruises together and they get lecturers, and I'm preparing a speech on this exact topic. That's why I bring this up. But there's two tracks to this speech. I'm doing how to use social media for fun and how to use social media for profit as a business. And they're really two very different kinds of things. You know, if you're a Facebook user, you know, most normal people, they use Facebook, they stay in touch with friends and family, they put up pictures, they share, you know, personal insights and stuff. That's not how a business should be using social media. A business should be using social media to have a conversation with its customers. Now, I use the word conversation intentionally because most businesses are not doing that. Most businesses use social media to broadcast to their customers. They don't, you know, businesses come from the idea that the same idea the old broadcasters came from. We talk, you listen, and you know, maybe they'll talk to a user if they have a problem. But what businesses really need to start doing with social media, and there are some businesses that are doing quite well with this, is have a conversation, an ongoing conversation, with their customers, not to see it as an opportunity to advertise, but as an opportunity to get to know the customer, get to know their wants and needs, and that the potential for that is huge. Most online businesses don't get it. There are a few that do. You know, it's interesting. Ford, which is a sponsor of my networks, has a very big presence on Facebook, on Google Plus, on Twitter. They're very active. They use Twitter the way a lot of companies do to kind of respond to customer problems. But they use Facebook, and they now have their own web pages as well to do the same thing. They have a social media page, social.ford.com, as a way of at least beginning this conversation with customers. And I think it's really interesting to watch these companies try to understand what social media is all about. It's pretty easy for us as individuals to use it. It's, you know, if you have a Facebook account, I think one of the reasons Facebook's so successful is you immediately get the idea. Wow, this is great. Right. I can stay in touch with friends and family that I'm out of touch with. I mean, you know, you said you watched the screensavers. My old co-host, Kate Patello, she moved to Michigan with Ray, one of our lab guys, and they got married. They've been living there for years. I kind of got out of touch with her. But thanks to Facebook, I can see what she and Ray are up to. I can see what their business is. We can even message back and forth. And I think that's great. And that's an obvious use that normal people get. Businesses have to do something, I think, very different.
Now, what would be the difference? I mean, you know, it's one thing, and I was talking to with one of our viewers, he had brought the point up. He said, you know, look, because he follows me on the Facebook, he follows me on Twitter, and my personal Facebook page and the Robert Christian Show Facebook page, and he said, look, I've noticed this. He said, you know, you really need to separate your business ventures and your business deals from your personal. And sometimes it is a bit difficult to separate the two of them.
Yeah, and I think it's very important to do that. You don't want to treat – I mean, I don't think this is so much of a problem. I think most businesses understand that their Facebook page isn't a place for the boss to show, you know, his sausage making and you know, here's pictures of my pet. Although I got to say, Mark Zuckerberg pretty much fills his Facebook page with pictures of his dog Beast. But I think Ford and the other companies that use Facebook effectively, Coca-Cola or whatever, kind of understand that this isn't, you know, we don't want no oversharing here. This is a chance to be a business online, but to have a communication, something you can't do very easily normally with customers, with your customers. I think Ford and Coca-Cola are a really good comparison, because Coca-Cola really uses Facebook as a big ad.
Right.
I don't think that's the right way to do it. General Motors, for instance, stopped advertising on Facebook. They couldn't quite figure out what they were getting from Facebook versus what they might get from an ad in Car and Driver. I think it's difficult for companies. You know, companies have to really struggle in this new internet era to reinvent themselves. And I think one thing we know as new media broadcasters, as podcasters, is that it's all about community. It's all about conversation between you and your audience. It's not about broadcasting. It's about, you know, talking. And so I think these companies have to rethink their point of view on Facebook. And some companies are doing it, but very few. Most see it as a big banner ad, and that's dumb.
Right. Now, here's a good question that I've been thinking about, and at least, you know, a good handful of our normal viewers have heard this, at least in part. But how can media streams like this one, like yours, like anybody else's stream, how can it become more effective and attractive?
Well, I think the first thing to understand is it isn't your father's broadcasting. I think what happened when the internet, you know, and digital technology exploded on the scene, and it's only been a couple of decades, is that people at first, this always happens with any new medium, first interpreted it through the filter of what they already knew. So if you were a magazine, you treated the internet as a way to publish magazines. If you were a radio host, as a way to publish radio shows. If you're a TV host, as a way to do TV shows. You know, what I look back to an earlier medium. I've talked about this many times in my speeches, and now my friend Jeff Jarvis is also big on this. But when Gutenberg invented movable type, when he invented printing, for the first, almost the first 100 years, the only thing they did with it was what they'd already been doing. And they just replaced the monks who were handwriting Bibles. They printed Bibles because they saw it through the filter of what they already knew. Oh, it's a Bible printer. And it took a couple of generations to get that the printing press could be so much more. And that's when suddenly novels and plays and all sorts of new forms of literary creativity emerged, because suddenly you could mass publish content. And I think the same thing happened with the internet. Initially, we just did more of the same. We said, oh, it's a new way of distributing records. And it's taken us a while. I think we're still in the process of learning that it is its own medium, that it isn't, that it's something different, something new. In fact, it'll probably not be us, Robert, but our children who grew up with the internet, who really kind of use it in its own natural way. We're still trying to bend it a little bit to our will. I think for a broadcaster, when they come to the internet, what they have to really understand is we're monologists, you know, on talk radio even, and certainly on TV. We talk, you listen. Shut up, sit down, watch our show. Right. And on the internet, it really has the opportunity to be much more of a conversation. And instead of a monologue, a dialogue, instead of saying, you're the audience, sit down in your seats and watch me perform, we say, we're a community. We're creating together. And I believe that is the primary thing that a broadcaster coming to the internet has to understand, or anybody, frankly. I look at people like Cory Doctorow, who's a fantastic science fiction author, who does understand the internet, who uses the internet in his publishing. You know, he gives his books away for free as well as selling them. He's done some really interesting stuff. He really gets it, that this is something new and different, and he's experimenting with it. I don't think we'll see the full fruit of this for a while. It took 100 years for the printing press to be anything more than a Bible press. I don't think it's going to take 100 years for the internet, but it's going to take maybe another generation.
We have a question actually in the chat. I don't know if you actually are looking at it. Leo, do you think that podcasters are important for streams starting out to gain advertisers? From what I've seen, the numbers are hard to track.
Yeah, I mean, we decided there's two ways. Actually, there's several ways, but there's kind of two or three primary ways you can go if you want to be a broadcaster on the internet to monetize it. I mean, one way to go is just say, hey, it's a hobby. I'm going to enjoy it and have fun. And frankly, I tell podcasters that's probably the best bet because your likelihood of being able to make a living at this is low right now. It's early days. It's way too early days. The other way to go is to ask for subscriptions or demand subscriptions to create a paywall around it and say you have to pay for the content. I'm not a fan of the paywall, but that's certainly one way to go. There are a few people who've made that work. Wall Street Journal makes that work, for instance. Another way to go is to give it away freely and ask for donations. That was the path that we initially took, you know, kind of the public radio model. And it didn't work too well for TWiT. I found, and it's interesting, public radio has found this as well, that about 4%, somewhere between 2 and 4% of your audience will donate. No more. Most people will just say, yeah, I'll give someday, or I like this for free. So the fourth and final way, and I think the most important way to do that for me, and the way we've decided to do this is with, is ad-supported free media. And I think that is something people are used to. That's how radio and TV generally work. There is pay TV, but most, you know, network television is ad-supported free media. So that's how, we do it. But that is difficult because this is all new for advertisers. They're not really sure how it works. You mentioned the measurement issue. I don't think that's a big issue. We can actually we know better who's watching and how many people are watching than, say, a network television show. They have to use people meters and Nielsen rating services, right? And they use statistical sampling. We know exactly how many people download a given show. Exactly. Now, don't tell the advertisers this. We can't guarantee that somebody who downloaded a show listened to it, but you can't guarantee that somebody who bought a magazine read it either. So, ultimately for an advertiser, it's going to come down to, we charge them for the number of impressions we make, the number of eyeballs watching. But ultimately, whatever it is they pay for the ad, it has to make sense for them. They have to get more business, it has to make money for them. It has to get more business for them than it costs. And so we give them numbers, we charge by the numbers. The numbers are not hard to get. Any download service will give you numbers. And then what we try to do is set a price that makes the most money we can, but still is profitable for the advertiser. The advertiser has to win and we have to win. And so we try to make it a success for both of us. But look, there's only a handful of podcasts that are successfully monetized. It's so new. There's a small number of companies who even understand it. And so we're working. And it's my kind of – I feel like it's my – part of my mission is to – win over advertisers, to show them that our shows on TWiT, we have about 25 shows. Those shows do make advertisers money. They do have advertising. We are very profitable. And part of that is it would be tragic if we failed from my point of view, because it would in a way be confirming the belief of many that, oh, podcasts don't work. So it's really important to me that every advertiser who's on our network has a success. And what I want them to do is go out and tell other agencies and other advertisers, hey, this podcasting thing, it kind of works. And I think over time, as the handful of companies that are successful doing this, people like Adam Carolla, Revision 3, as we continue to do well, it will slowly, the word will spread. Wow, this works. And in fact, it's my belief that we work, and I know, in fact, we work better than network television advertising. So I expect that a significant portion of the many billions of dollars, I can't remember what it is, $60 or $70 billion that's spent each year on network television advertising, I think 10% of that will start flowing to podcasting because we can give you better numbers. We can prove our effectiveness. We have a more engaged audience because we've built a community. We've built an audience that cares and is interacting with us. And I think that that's ultimately good for advertisers. It's also important, and we really work hard at this, that go ahead.
I want to bring this up, Leo. You know, I showed this to you prior, this mount, which I think is a cool idea. I had no idea. I mean, I'm in like the 1980s somewhere, lost under a rock. But this mount, okay. I think it's a pretty cool thing myself, if I can say so. But for someone like the designer who did this, he's using Kickstarter as his social media, I guess, for other people to donate to him, to help him to get it out there in the hands of others, even. But is that really going to be of a big asset to him using like Kickstarter for a project like this? Or is that really going to be not the best the best thing that he could possibly use?
Kickstarter is really interesting, and there's other companies like Indiegogo doing something similar. The idea, Kickstarter was originally created to help creatives, novelists, filmmakers, musicians fund their projects. So if you're a musician, in the old way it worked, you'd kind of struggle. Maybe you'd make a cheap demo tape because it's expensive to get studio time. But the idea was get a record company, because a record company will foot the bill for the expensive recording session, for the promotion, for the distribution. What if, and of course we're seeing that model is falling apart right now thanks to the internet, what if you could get potential listeners to pay up front for an album, and by getting a small percentage of them to commit to $5 or $10, you can get enough money together that you can then produce the album and sell it. So that's why Kickstarter was started. It's a little confusing, I think, because you're not really investing. You're not going to get stock in the company. You're not going to necessarily even get an album. And this is something that's recently come up. There was a video game called Haunts that raised $29,000, and they've thrown in the towel. Those people who invested in Haunts, they're not going to get a game. They gave up. And I think you're going to see this more and more on Kickstarter. So Kickstarter has of late kind of made an effort to remind people, this isn't a store. You're not buying something. What you're doing is telling a company or an individual, hey, we like this idea. We'd like to help you create it. Here's $5 or $10. And if you do end up making a car doc or an album or a novel or a play or a movie, we'll get a copy of it. But Kickstarter is saying, and I think it's really important for people to understand, this isn't a store. Because I think people go there and they see these products and they say, oh, good, I want that. That's not, you're not guaranteed to get it. In fact, I've participated in more than half a dozen Kickstarter projects, and I've only received one of them. Some of them are more than a year old, and I've never received anything. So it's really important for people to understand. This isn't a marketplace.
Well, no, it isn't. It's like you say, it's not a store. But
it looks like the one, though, Robert, and that's what's confusing to people.
It really
does. So your friend who's – what's his name? Robert Garcia? Is that his name?
Randy.
Randy Garcia. Your friend who's created the idea of this mount – is asking people to donate on Kickstarter. That's fantastic, but people shouldn't go to that page and say, oh, look, I'm going to get this thing. What you're saying is, here's some money, Randy. Good luck. I hope you can make that. And if you do, would you send me one?
Well, exactly. Now, in his case, and I guess, you know, speaking out of the mind of Randy for a minute, what can he do? What would you encourage him to do to use Kickstarter, for an example,
well, it's great.
Use the Facebook, the Twitter, for his advantage, to be able to do what he wants to do, what his dream
is. It's great, but I got to tell you, there are a lot of people, there have always been people, and they used to call my radio, they still call my radio show all the time, they say, I have an idea for a product that's going to, I know will make $1 million. And mostly these people are completely deluded. And they think, if only I could get it manufactured, or if only I could get it patented, or if only, I'm going to be a millionaire. And the real truth of the matter is, if you talk to people who've brought products to the market, that the idea is the smallest part of the problem. Ideas are easy. What's hard is getting it manufactured. And then the hardest thing is getting it in stores so people can buy it.
Right.
That's the most difficult thing to do. And these inventors think, this idea will sell itself. No idea sells itself. So Kickstarter is just the beginning part. Kickstarter is, it's wonderful. It helps people get the capital together to take the next step. But it by no means finishes the product. This Haunts game is a perfect example. They raised $29,000. They put that money towards the expenses they'd already put in of $42,000. They still didn't get a game. Two of the programmers have now left to go to real jobs. There will never be a game. And even if there had been a game, there's no guarantee it would be a good game, that it would be picked up for distribution, that anybody would ever see it, because all of those things have to be done too. So Kickstarter is only one part. The idea in Kickstarter is only half, maybe not even that much, of the process involved in getting to market. It is not a panacea. And I think, to expand this, social media is not a panacea. It's not the magic bullet that's going to solve all your problems. It's just a new way to market.
Well, I think that looking at the social media and the world of social media, here in the last year, it has exploded. I look at the Occupy Wall Street movement, a good example. They are using streams like nobody's business, really. The quality sometimes is a little bit iffy. But again, granted, we got to remember what they're actually using is cell phones in most cases. They're not out there with the DSLR cameras or any of this stuff. I'd be happy to have one of those. They have pressed the envelope a bit. Have you actually learned anything from the Occupy movement since they started?
Occupy is one example. I mean, you can also look to the Arab Spring that we had last year, where Facebook and Twitter were used to overthrow the Egyptian government and other governments. It's powerful, but really it's just another medium for the voice of the people. I think smart organizers, and by the way, it's not just protesters. Look at Mitt Romney and Barack Obama. Smart. If you are not using social media effectively, you're not in the game. Right. I think if you're smart and you're paying attention, you're using all the tools that are available. And for some, if you're a political candidate, you have money. First, you got to raise money, and you've got money, you can buy television ads. But if you're a protest movement, hey, Facebook and Twitter, these are great ways to get the word out.
Well, you more or less challenging, and I want to sort of push the envelope. What is it that people are missing, Leo, when it comes to social media, networking? What is it that they're missing? Because somewhere something is definitely amiss. When it comes to either fundraising, when it comes to raising awareness of a cause, of a stream, an environment, a thing that's going on, and I've noticed, you know, one guy will say, hey, I just went to the bathroom, right? He posted it on Facebook, and suddenly he's got 10,000 likes. But somebody else say, look, we're going to have somebody else on the show, this is what the Occupy is doing, or this is what is kind of going on in the real world, and you have zero actual participation. What do you think of that?
It just tells you something about human nature, doesn't it? We might be more interested. There was a great article in the Sunday New York Times this past Sunday, a great editorial cartoon in the opinion section. It was exactly that. It was all the issues that are not being mentioned by the candidates, from, Syria to economic inequality in the United States, things that the candidates are just not saying anything about. But then the guy, and so the and the guy isn't couldn't care less about any of this stuff. But then in the last panel, he says, "Oh, the guy I don't like made some gaffe online. Wow, now I'm outraged." And it really is speaks more to human nature than anything else. Sometimes it's hard for us to understand the big issues; they're complicated. But everybody goes to the bathroom or has a nice sandwich, and so that stuff might get more likes on Facebook. Hey, that's the way the world is. You know, Facebook and Google and Twitter don't have a responsibility for changing the world; they just reflect us.
Right. You know, I agree. You know, I still wonder though, because some folks, some streams, some procasters, some podcasters, and we're actually, I'm actually talking with our administrator right now about starting our podcast. After all this time, he's been saying, you know what, this is what to do. Do you think, in your own way of thinking, that doing a podcast is worth the time to do it?
No, only if you can.
That was quick.
No, and it's the same question if you ask me about writing a novel or composing a symphony. These things are hard. They're much hard. You know, one podcast, easy. A podcast a week for 5 years, hard. But that's what you need to do to succeed. You could only write a novel, compose a symphony, or do a podcast successfully if it's all you can do, if you can't not do it. It's what you have to do. It's what you want to do. It's what you do out of your passion. You shouldn't engage in any, in my opinion, in any artistic endeavor because it seems like a good idea or because maybe somebody told you it was going to be fun. You should do it because you can't not do it. And I think podcasting's right in there. It is, you know, it's hard work. You've got to create something on a consistent basis. Right. You have to work hard to reach an audience. When you create a podcast, at first, five people might listen to it, and three of them are family members. But you have to keep going. It's the same thing with a blog. Right. You shouldn't write a blog because you think it's a good idea. You should write a blog because it's your passion, because you have something to say, and you really got to say it. And that's what keeps you going through the times that are tough until you, if ever, get to the point where you have a bigger audience, and then you can start thinking about things like, well, maybe I can make a living doing this. Maybe, you know, I got into radio because I loved it, not because I thought logically, oh, this seems like a good idea.
Well, you know, Leo, when I was a kid, I was born in Dallas, and many, many moons ago, you know, I remember getting an old AM radio, you know. And one day I decided to take the freaking thing apart because I wanted to see what was inside of it, to see if there was actually a little man, a little figure in there running around that played all the instruments and did all the talk shows. And I took it apart and I put it back together and the freaking thing worked.
See?
Back in the day. You know, any of that stuff.
That's a good sign, I think.
You know, yeah, it is. But, you know, going from the old tube-type radios or the old shortwave radios, you probably remember those back in the day. Going from that to what we have today and how technology has changed, how can we as people get out of the tubes from the old tube-type radios and get into the into technology, into social media, and for it to have a blasting and a positive effect on our life?
I have to say, you know, I'm a ham, which is the kind of old school analog radio.
You start mentioning still a hammer.
Well, I haven't done much with it. You know, and before I became a ham, my question was, well, this seems like an awful lot of trouble for something you could do really easily with Skype. You know, why don't I need to get radios and build antennas? And you don't become a ham because it's a better way to communicate. You become a ham because you're interested in how it works and it's fun and it's a hobby.
Oh, tell me, you used to have a CB radio.
I never was a CB, but I always loved shortwave. And I used to, when I was a kid, scan that I was, you know, try really hard to listen to Russian radio stations and things like that. Now you got the internet. You can listen to any radio station in the world in much better quality, much more easily. Where's the fun in that, right? I did it for fun. But if what you wanted was the information or, you know, the communication, well, it's much, much easier now. to do it digitally. And yet, you know, there are more hams now than ever before. Ham radio, amateur radio, is growing really rapidly. And I think some of that is people are interested in how stuff works. I think it's really important to learn how it's important to take apart radios, learn how stuff works, because who's going to build the next generation of stuff if we don't learn how it works?
You know, I remember, Leo, you'll probably get a laugh at it, but I used to work at an AM radio station, an old country radio station. I remember lightning. It was in the middle of a lightning storm. Lightning struck the tower, and the transmitter came out of the closet where it was. It was like a 30,000 watts. I can't remember the wattage. Anyway, the whole transmitter blew out of the closet on its feet, standing straight up. And so I got the dolly, put it back in. But I queued up the mic and I said, "Hey, Don, the studio was out of power." And I said, "Don," he was the manager, "Hey, the studio is we just got hit by lightning." And then I went over after the smoke cleared and put the transmitter back in the closet, took the tube out of there, and I remember unscrewing it and fixing it with aluminum foil and putting it back in there, and the freaking thing worked. For a long time it did. But going from that, the old tube type, and that was scary, I'm telling you. But going from that to this, it's completely night and day.
No kidding. And what's amazing is, well, here's a good example. You and I are talking over Skype. This sounds better than a telephone, right?
Yes.
The telephone was designed by engineers at the turn of the last century to use the smallest amount of, they didn't call it bandwidth, but in effect bandwidth, that was possible and still understand the human voice. They tried all different frequencies. They got it down to a very narrow amount of data because the copper didn't have the carrying capacity. They didn't want to use more energy than they had to. And even though those scarcities aren't really an issue anymore, the telephone system still has that, what is it, 6-bit sound that it's always had. It sounds terrible. When the engineers designed Skype, they didn't have those constraints. They said, well, you know, people are going to have a lot of bandwidth. They're going to have a couple hundred kilobits at least. So let's use a higher quality codec. Let's use more bandwidth. Then you can hear the voice. Then they added video. And so, you know, I think about television. You know, the television interlacing and the original way TV was done is because the hardware couldn't handle that much data. So instead of drawing 400 lines all at once, they'd draw 100 lines and then the other 100 lines in alternating frames. Persistence of vision meant that it looked like you were watching a picture. That kind of interlaced television persists even today, even though modern hardware has plenty of capacity. That's why newer televisions don't do interlacing. They do progressive scan, and instead of 400 lines, they have 1,080 lines or even more of resolution. They got plenty of bandwidth.
Well,
so
let me ask you, I don't know if you remember, but it happened over a weekend here in North America, where people on the East Coast suddenly on their old analog televisions were getting the BBC right from London. We were in Dallas, and I remember watching Channel 2 out of Miami just as if the station was next door, seriously, and that was on television.
Huh.
It was a serious thing going on.
Was it some sort of atmospheric disturbance? Is that what it was?
I can only assume. It was clearer than what was that channel? WFAA TV in Dallas. It was clearer than them, and we live way closer to it. It's just bizarre. I've got another question. Do you remember a caller that was in on your show? His name was Andrew.
That's all you're going to tell me? No, I don't.
No, first you remember.
you know, I get a lot of calls.
Yes.
Yes. No, tell me more.
He was the gentleman that is disabled, and he had asked, and he was talking about a service dog.
Oh, yeah. He was trying to raise money for his service dog, wasn't he?
He got his service dog.
That's great. What a nice story.
And yes, he did. And
that was through a kind of a Kickstarter-like service called, I can't remember, was it Fund Me or something like
GoFundMe,
Fund
okay.
Me? Yeah, and you know, that was a really kind of a neat example of GoFundMe. Was that it? That was a really neat example. Yeah, GoFundMe.com, of a guy who didn't have the resources to get his service dog, but and frankly, you know, friends and family couldn't fund it either. So he was, you know, the truth is he was lucky. He got through on the radio show and was able to mention it on the radio show, and enough people were moved by his story that he could raise the money.
Well, you
There's
know,
a lot of people, if you look on here, there's a lot of people with similar stories. I don't know if GoFundMe is the solution to all of this, but that was a great story with a happy ending.
it definitely is. And you know, as we're talking about technology, social media, last year, we were involved here on the show of raising money, and it made some people quite furious, some other people not so much. For a wheelchair, a manual wheelchair, and those are expensive. Leo, we were like 12 hours nonstop raising
Oh,
money
that's
for it.
great. And did you get it in the end?
Yes.
Yay. That's great.
And it was a very, very much needed chair, specialized. And so, yes, we were able to get it. But you know, it made some people very furious, and I got one of the best compliments out of a slam that, from ever before here on the show. And somebody said, look, listening to him talking about me, they go, listening to him reminds me of listening to AM radio on the weekends. And I busted out laughing because they meant it to be a slam. And I thought, hey, that is a slam dunk. Exactly. So when you're dealing with social media, in my opinion, I think that it can help people, yes. But not everybody, of course, is going to be of a giving nature, or not everybody is going to be of an understanding nature. But how is it that you can get massive Twitter followers, Facebook followers, people, you know, going from point A, which may be Twitter, to point B, which might be your stream or your podcast? How do you get them off of their duff with a click of a button?
Well, I mean, one problem is you can't go to that well too often because people get fatigued after a while. But if it's something you know, that makes a difference and people are moved by it, I think once in a while it's a great idea. I get, you know, we were talking about national public radio. They ask for money an awful lot, and I get very tired of it, even though they're a really good cause and they deserve to be funded. They can't put ads on there. But even then, you know, I hear those pledge breaks and I go, oh, no, not again. It's a fine line. You got to ask enough to survive, but not so much that you turn people off. It was one of the reasons, frankly, that we're ad supported. I don't want to spend a lot of time begging on the air. Although I have to say, you know, one of the inspirations, oddly enough, for what I do on Twit on the air is a preacher that I used to see all the time, who would sit on TV and he would do the funniest things. You can actually, he's passed away a long time ago, but you can actually still see his stuff on YouTube, I think. His name was Gene Scott, and
Okay,
he
I
would.
know him.
Do you remember him?
Yes, yes,
He
yes.
was. I was mesmerized. I never gave him any money, but I was mesmerized because he would do things like he would just sit there and he said, "I'm not going to talk until I get $1,000."
Right.
And he'd just stare around. The guy would wear funny hats.
He'd
He'd wear
smoke a cigar, I
sometimes
remember.
smoke a cigar. He'd have four different glasses. Sometimes he'd preach, but not. It was a fascinating show, and what stuck with me was I was mesmerized by it. And in some ways, now I don't do that. I don't ask for money on the air, but I do have to say that some of what we do on Twit is somewhat influenced by the idea of this crazy old coot who just sits on TV and says, I'm not going to say anything till you give me $1,000."
Exactly.
It just cracked me up. He's actually, you can read about Gene Scott on Wikipedia. He passed away about 5 or 6 years ago. But he was quite the character.
Yes, he was. Actually, he still has the stream up, you know, the university church or whatever it is.
No kidding.
But it's still up. You can still watch a lot of his, most all of his reruns.
Yeah, I mean, he was buying time, you know, middle of the night channels and so forth. He would have loved the internet.
Oh, by all means.
Yeah.
Someone in the chat, so how does the average new media broadcaster get advertising? Obviously, as your situation, Leo, is different from someone else or someone starting out. You've been in there for a while.
Well, the way we started, the first couple of years, I said, and I said it publicly, much to my embarrassment later, that we will never take advertising. I said, you know, I don't want to take advertising because, and this is, you know, the other side of the coin is you're then kind of considered corrupted that, well, now, you know, this company, Ford, is paying you for ads. Can I trust your opinion of Ford anymore? And so we were really careful about picking stuff that I already had used and already liked. But still, you know, it's a little bit compromising. So I thought, I don't want to take ads. I want it to be direct drive. I want the audience to fund it. And what we found after a couple of years is the audience didn't fund it enough even just to pay me a barely minimum wage, let alone hire staff and do more shows. And I really wanted to do that. So I had already talked for a while with a guy at a company. His idea was to become an advertising agency for podcasts. And a company was, we still use them. It was called Podtrac, PODTRAC.com.
I've heard of them. Okay.
Yeah. And this fella, Mark McCrary, he'd called me and said, well, can we help you sell advertising? I said, I'm never taking advertising, Mark, but I will talk to you and tell you what podcasters want and need so you can have some idea as you build your business. So we had a relationship. After a couple of years, I called him back and said, Mark, you know what I said about never taking advertising? Maybe we should take some advertising. And we, bit by bit, we'd have companies call us and we'd refer them to Mark. And actually, our first advertiser came to us before Mark. It was a security firm called Astaro. And we made a little here, a little there. But Mark spent a lot of time going, you know, burning shoe leather, going from agency to agency, and really educating them on podcasts. He put together a rating system and so forth, which any podcaster could use. So that was really, if it hadn't been for them, I don't know, I couldn't certainly have sold any advertising. And I didn't want to, because it was bad enough to have the advertising on. I didn't want to have too close a relationship with these companies. I wanted to kind of preserve a firewall between editorial and advertising. So Mark made that possible. Now, since as we've grown, we continue to use Podtrac, and they do a lot of ad sales for us. But we've started to do our own in-house sales, and we're using other companies as well. You know, as we've become better known and our product has become more successful, we're able to sell ads a lot more easily and even do it ourselves. But it was very hard in the beginning. Nobody wanted to – it was – you know, any buy we got would be an experimental buy. And it's still hard because the dollars are low, so agencies don't make enough money on the sales. You know, say agencies that make ad buys make their money through commissions, so they'd much rather do a $5 million buy than a $500,000 buy. It, you know, they make 10 times more. So they're not even really looking at the small buys that you have to do on podcasts. That was one of Mark's insights, and one of the things Mark said is, well, we'll make them bigger buys by aggregating a bunch of podcasts together. So if you're starting out, I'd suggest – and by the way, there were other companies – trying to do the same thing. Most of them have fallen by the wayside. Podtrac is still out there, still doing a great job. So if you're starting out as a podcaster, I'd certainly go there. Go to podtrac.com. You can get start the measurement service right away for free, and it'll give you some idea of what you might be able to make. But again, I don't think you should get into podcasting to make money. I have all these advantages. You know, I was on, as you mentioned, on Tech TV, so a lot of people knew me. I do a radio show that's in 180 markets in the U.S., so I can promote my podcast through the radio show. I have a lot of advantages. I was a known quantity somebody just kind of saying, well, I think I'm going to do this, isn't going to have. And even I found it difficult at first. But again, what I'm hoping is, you know, that a rising tide raises all boats, that by being successful at doing this, we will inspire others to do it and other advertisers to buy podcasts. Because I really believe podcasts advertising is a much better much more efficient way to spend your dollar. And our advertisers agree. We rarely lose advertisers. Almost all of our advertisers have been with us for years because it works.
I think it's great. Even around here, getting advertisers, getting people that is so keyed up on what you're doing. But as I look at it, though, I mean, if it were some other kind of a show, if it was a sports-related show, for a good example, then trust me, I would imagine there'll be very little problem with getting sports-related advertisers on or people that are in that field supporting what you're doing. But when you're into news talk or when you're into tech TV, that is Twit TV, what you do, that is a completely, that's sort of separating yourself out from the rest. So you've sort of created your own wheel.
Well, you know, I'm not convinced sports would do better. You know, you might be able to, advertisers, you know, I always thought, for instance, if you did a show about alcohol, like Tiki Bar TV, it'd be easy to get alcohol companies to buy you. And Tiki Bar TV went away. It was all about mixing drinks. It had a drink recipe of the week, and it was a great show with a sexy co-host, and it was funny, and it was really well done, and they could never get any advertising. They might be able to today, but at the time, they couldn't get any advertising. And so I think it's kind of counterintuitive. You know, you could do a sports show on the internet, but would you get an audience? That's, you know, you got to get an audience before you can make any money in advertising. One of the reasons technology has worked for us is because our audience is early adopters. We know they're all on the internet, and they all have computers, and they all know how to download shows or watch shows live. So I feel like we're going to, you know, it's easier for us to build an audience than it would be for a knitting channel, for instance. Sports, though, you're right, Robert. Sports might have a good shot at it, because I think more and more people are watching streaming sports and things like that.
Well, I can't say, hey, we're gonna do a Sportsplex show, right? good God.
Nor am I. I know tech, and one of the things we've decided to do is stick to our knitting. We know what we're doing. We're going to continue to do that.
Well, you know, some people are very good at knitting and crocheting. Not this old boy. Well, Leo, I do want to thank you very, very much for your time being live with me today. I've really looked forward to it. Although I've still got my play like list written down, and I think asked two of the questions that were on there. but you know, there is a lot of misconstrued understandings maybe when it comes to the internet, when it comes to social networking. As a closing statement, what would you tell our viewers?
Don't be afraid. I think a lot of people are afraid of the internet and of security, and perhaps afraid of the internet undermining their business, perhaps afraid of not being smart enough or not understanding it. You know what? You can do this. It's great. The water's fine. Jump on in. Enjoy yourself on the internet. If you want to do a podcast or a blog, do it. Don't be afraid of it. And don't ever feel like you're not smart enough, because you are. And the internet is just an amazing, I think it's the most powerful invention humankind has ever seen. And its power to change the world is unlimited, so take advantage of it.
Hey, you know, I totally agree. The world is our oyster. It's time to go out there and start harvesting, right?
I like it.
Well, thank you very, very much again, Leo. It has been a pleasure and a great honor. You have no idea.
Thank you, Robert. It's been a real pleasure.
And I hope to be able to, hey, I'll tweet you back and forth. So just look for my tweets. And
I'll watch for your tweets, sir.
And hopefully your email thing will not decide, oh, that's junk email anymore.
Well, Robert, I don't know if you saw, we were talking about email about a week ago on one of my shows. And our guest, Cory Doctorow, said, is that right? Do you have 25,000 unread messages in your email? And I said, yeah, that's right. I get a lot of mail and I can't keep up. So if you send me an email, just keep bothering me until I answer.
All right, will do. But I do greatly appreciate your free help. And, you know, like I say, no, I'm not going to sit back and just be bothersome to you. But
that's quite all right.
But I do greatly appreciate it. And you have a fantastic day for what is left of it.
My pleasure. Thank you, Robert.
All right,
take care.
Thank you so very much, Leo.
Bye-bye.
All right, folks, that is Leo Laporte, the king of tech. And My heavens, folks. I am completely elated. And I hope that everybody else here is as well. Hey, folks, we are going to take a short break here on the show. And then when we get back, folks, we are going to maybe do a good brief overture of what people think and what they learned from Leo Laporte today. And yep. Wow. So, hey, let me know what you all think. Folks, again, we're going to take a short break. Let me know what you all think. And yes, if you all would like to follow the show, you can. It's simple. Follow us on Twitter at NewsTalk2, on Facebook, Robert Christian Show. And yes, folks, we are doing our yearly fundraiser of sort to help us to stay on the air for the next year. Meanwhile, folks, hang out, enjoy yourself, and I shall return. Folks, I'm Robert Christian with the Robert Christian Show. Join us Monday through Friday right here for the Robert Christian Show as we discover news, breaking news, politics, religion, you name it. Folks, we have an incredible opportunity, a dynamic opportunity right now to use social media at its best. So we invite you to use your social media, folks, and go to YouTube, type in The Robert Christian Show. Hey, we're also on Twitter. You can find us there at NewsTalk2. Folks, we are everywhere. Visit us on our website, www.robertchristianshow.com, and see what we're about, folks. We have an incredible opportunity right now, and I want to encourage you to take this opportunity, folks, to get involved beyond the social realm of social media and get involved in your media. Folks, this is the Robert Christian Show, where your voice and your opinion, they matter.
You're watching The Robert Christian Show. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
All right, folks, we are back with the Robert Christian Show, and hello, it's welcome. It is a nice welcome, rather, to see everyone on tap here today, folks. Hey, what did everybody learn? Hopefully something good from Leo Laporte, and I honestly hope that everybody did get a little something out of the conversation with social media. No, I didn't get all of the questions asked that I had. However, folks, I do want to bring up once again, Randy. I don't know if you're in the chat, but if you are, feel free to post your Kickstarter page in the chat there. This device, folks, I think it's kind of cool. And once and providing that this entire project does get funded, I would like to get one of the new revisions of it. However, this is a product, folks, that you can hook up, put your cell phone right up to your windshield of your car, and it is really cool. And it comes with a little tripod, little miniature. What is that, like a 5-inch tripod, something like that? When I saw it, I thought, oh, how cute, how dainty. So it has a lot of different uses, of course, for it. And I think for anybody who would go and want to do live broadcasting, and, you know, how many of you have ever, for the record, how many of you have ever, come on, be honest, watched the Storm Chasers live on the air before through the internet? We've aired them. And what was it, earlier this year, we had them live, two or three of them live, and we were able live to see several tornadoes touch the ground. What a horrific event that is, but we saw it live. And the local news media and things, they'd get a hold of it and say, hey, yeah, that was a pretty good piece of footage. Well, we were able to see the whole thing. So I think that one of these devices, folks, would really come in handy for even those folks. A good suction cup, yes, yes, yes. You know what? Too often suction cups lose their suction. And so, hey, folks, this is the Robert Christian Show, and I do want to take this opportunity, ladies and gentlemen, to welcome you. I'm going to talk just for a second about the presidential debate that is scheduled for tonight. I don't know how many of you are going to be watching it. It will be the third and the last presidential debate for this election. Some folks have already voted. Here in Washington State, there were three major things on the ballot to vote for. Same-sex marriage was one of them. Legalizing marijuana in the state was another one. And, of course, voting for the presidency. And I did vote live, and I showed everybody what my vote was. And folks, that was for the second time in 8 years have I done that live on the air. I don't have anything to hide. And what I'm looking for, folks, are people who are going to be willing to accept a challenge and to step up to the plate and say, you know what, we can do something. There's an old word a long time ago, and Leo, I don't know if you're still watching, but an old word, and it was called FANAPI, find a need and fill it. There are a lot of needs, of course, everywhere. But in the world of social media, folks, sometimes you run into very bad stories. You run into to people that need help. But yet at other times, you run into people that just want to be your friend and have fun. So what do you do? And how do you use your social media to your benefit? What do you actually do? Folks, I want to be persuaded, personally. I want to be persuaded to think, you know what, we can use social media at its best. There is a reason for it. There is a reason why that we in this generation, that we can use social media. You know, folks, back in the day, people did not have the opportunity of such social media as that we do today. Andrew from Portland, welcome. Andrew. Maybe he's...
It was muted.
Oh, there he is. Hello, good morning, Andrew.
Good morning, Rob.
So, how do you use... And I want to get a little nosy. How do you use social media?
Two ways. Personal and to gain business contacts, I think would be the simplest answer to that. Well, I'm part of a networking group that Randy is also a part of, and I won't name just because I don't know if we should advertise it or not. But, and I find a lot of connections there that help me get, you know, from point A to B to C to D to E. So a lot of times I'm on social media looking for people to help me connect, I don't know, connect the dots, so to speak.
Well, I look at social media, you know, in an entirely different way, I think. It is powerful. But what is, in your opinion, and this is, I guess this question is strictly opinion-based, what can people do, Andrew? And you've been around the block a time or three. What can people do when it comes to social media? That social media will then just explode under their feet and be such a vital part of their everyday life versus people that may be afraid of using social media. And like Leo was talking about, don't be afraid.
What Leo said is pretty much dead on what I would tell you.
Well, do you think that that Leo was right on target? I mean, granted, I know that there's a lot of people that are very afraid of using social media for whatever reason. But why? Why would people be so afraid and or so offended that, you know, by the look of Facebook or the look of Twitter, that they say, you know, look, I'm not gonna support the whatever that it is because hey, you're on Twitter or you're on Facebook.
Well, I hear it more with Facebook. It's because people, I know with a lot of people, it tends to be the issue of, you know, Facebook's privacy policies have been really back and forth, kind of wonky. Sometimes they're one way, sometimes they're another way. They make drastic privacy changes without saying anything, and then whoops. And, you know, that scares people. And especially given that it's a fairly new arena to be in, it doesn't surprise me that it would scare people.
Well, you know, there's all kinds. And I actually put it posted on the Facebook page late last night. Let's see, what is it? The Twitter. I'm trying to look at all these things. The YouTube, the Facebook. Oh my goodness, Google. Gee whiz. Yahoo chat even. You know, all these other places. Social networkings. Now looking at it, what is it maybe about Facebook that it has become such a mainstay for a lot of people? Versus, like, oh, remember back when the IRC chat was the big thing?
People are sheep, so they follow where the biggest number goes.
Absolutely, you know, I think so. You know, which even I think for a lot of independent streamers, a lot of independent media groups, I'll put it that way. You know, even for them, a lot of them are like, wait, you know, here we are, we're hurting. And unless that there's a fire lit somewhere, nobody wants to follow you.
Right. I mean, it's kind of like Leo said. I mean, what did he say? It took him like 5 years to really get full engaged and everything. It just, you have to, you know, work at it. And obviously, I know you have. And You know, it takes time, and it really takes time for people to adopt, especially people that aren't my age.
Well, folks that are in the chat, we welcome you. Please use Facebook, your Twitter. Let people know that we are live and on the air. And folks, if you would like to call in for the remainder of the show, I really would like to. It's so much easier to talk to people live on the air. And you can talk to me, folks. Call in using your Skype. News Talk 2 is the name that you would need to use.
Randy's installing Skype.
Yes, Randy, and I can't wait to talk to him. I'm elated. I'm very surprised at this device. I really am, and the tripod, that's top notch. That's a good little cute little thing. Speaking of tripods, folks, you know what? I've been on the air for a little over a year here on the internet, doing the Monday through Friday weekday shows. And I've seen a giant fluctuation here on the stream. This is the second stream. We moved from one stream to this one not that long ago. But I've seen a tremendous influx, right? At times when we've aired some things within the Occupy movement, okay, we've done that. Sometime it's deader than dead. At other times it is, we have a good number of folks in here. And what I do want to do, folks, is to get more and more and more people involved because, you know, Andrew, like I've told you, the mic, it's the people's mic. And I mean that because what good is a talk show unless you have people that are, really going to be active and participate in what you're doing.
I mean, it all takes time to do, and you know, the more you push, the more you do, the more people will find time to engage. You know, some people just won't engage, and frankly, that's just something you have to tolerate. And the ones that do engage, you have to embrace more.
Well, folks, I'll tell you about Leo. Leo he has been in and around the social networkings of a lot of things for a long time. He honestly has. However, you know, folks, I've got to look at this and say, you know what? You know, of anybody that knows really what time it is, he does, I think. So I want, again, folks, I want your opinion on that. Yep, absolutely. Hey, Andrew, are you still with us? I have no idea where Andrew took off to. All right, folks, we have Randy. He is the inventor. Hey, Randy, good to see you. Tell me about your invention.
Hey, Robert. Well, thanks for having me on the show, as well as connecting me with Leo with some of those questions. I made the mill amount as a result of, you know, obviously wanting to hold the prop my camera up. At the time that I made it, I had an iPhone 3GS, and a lot of products out there only allowed for maybe the iPhone 4 with a specific or with no case. So I made it to fit not only my iPhone 3GS at the time, but my wife, she has a Droid, so I had to make something that fits hers as well. You pointed out a couple of uses out of it. I actually use it as a dash cam because in my commute I have a lot of traffic. So seeing the clouds and seeing the commute from the eyes of a time-lapse app, it actually looked very captivating. So I'm doing a lot of time-lapse photography with this. I think Andrew mentioned that he might...
Well, my heavens, okay. I'm not exactly sure what happened there. Hey, folks, that's technology, right? Okay, wait a second here. Let me find... Where is my contacts? Okay, I will. Okay, I'll call Andrew back. Sorry about this, guys. Hang on, guys. Okay, Andrew, I'm having difficulty here trying to add. Okay, there it goes. Add. Very good. Hey, that worked. Okay, Randy, we are we're back live with you. I'm so sorry for that. I have no idea what happened. Randy.
There we go.
Okay, perfect. Okay, now I have actually both of you on screen.
Can you see Andrew?
Yep.
So, okay, so before we are sort of rudely interrupted by technology, again, tell me about this this device. I did get it, as you can see, through, in the mail. And I think it's a pretty cool invention. What made you decide to invent something like that?
Well, I had an iPhone 3GS at the time, about a year and a half ago, and I wanted something to hold my phone up. There were some things out there, but both of them required that I had a specific case. There were some that required that I didn't have any case anymore. Well, a lot of us prefer that. A certain case of my phone, the gear that I use a lot. It was just to be able to pop in my phone, my bike, my phone. So,
Randy, hang on just a second. Andrew, can you mute your mic for a minute for me? Okay, because it's I could hear you typing in your keypad. Keystrokes were a little bit louder than Randy's. Go ahead, Randy.
Well, so I also made it the Millimount so it can fit to pretty much any tripod, any standard tripod out there. This is one of my favorite ones. In fact, I can put this on the, don't have any walls that I can show you on, but on the corners of most walls, there's a steel or some kind of support that, you know, this magnetic tripod can actually attach to. So there's no place in my home that I can't set my phone and aim it in whatever direction I want. So I can use it for a number of things, between watching different things on my phone or using it to record different things.
Randy, can you before we go continue on? Can you mute the stream on your computer and just make sure that your Skype is left kind of alone? That because I'm getting some massive feedback from you.
Okay, so I do have my feed muted. This is the first time I've installed Skype.
Room noise.
Say again, Andrew.
Yes.
You cut yourself off a little soon.
It's room noise.
Okay, got it.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. Do you have do you have an aquarium or something or a fan going close to you?
It might be my my laptop fan, which has a silent mode, so take advantage of that.
Hey, okay. That's way better.
Okay. First time I had to use that silent mode.
Well, okay. So I did get your device. And you know, I'm happy with it. However, do you know if there is a patent for a product very similar to this that it's already out on the market?
There are several that are patent pending. Mine is also patent pending. But the ones that are out there right now only allow you to use either their case that comes with their device or no case. So that's where I kind of have an edge in the market with three uses out of this one device. So it could be a desktop fan. In the phones here, there's a spot for an iPhone or an iPod charger, except for the iPhone 5, of course. And it also can be, it's semi-open source, which means it's made so that people that want to make their own ideas can actually attach different accessories to it. On my Kickstarter page, I actually have a photo of my daughter using it with a bar that she mounted the phone to. And basically, it's, long story short, we can watch movies in bed without our hands, using the different channels that you see on the device there. So there's a lot of different ways that I'm leveraging that semi-open source aspect to the Kickstarter project. But of course, it's social media that I'm hoping will help with the driving the traffic to the project site. There's just over 2,000 views of the site, and there are about 280 backers. So it's a pretty good ratio, but if I have more zeros to that viewership, then that'll definitely help the campaign.
Well, as I understand it, this is not necessarily your first invention that you've invented.
I have a few, none that are patented, but I do have a manufacturer that I'm working with locally here in, actually local to you in Renton, and there are several other manufacturers around me that are starting to pick up on the different things that I'm working on. So to Leo's point, yeah, there are a lot of people out there that have this great idea, but is there a market? And if there is a market, well, how do they know what steps are needed once they get funding? And that's kind of the strength that I'm playing to with the recent problems that have been seen on Kickstarter with delays. I'm actually using that to my advantage, as in my campaign video, I actually state that I already have funding ready to go, manufacturers ready to go, all of that's ready to go, as long as the people that are going to give me money, and this is the side investor that I mentioned in my video. If they see that I cross that threshold, they're going to give you the money right away. So I don't have to wait for my project to actually end, or for that, I think it's a 2-week wait after a project gets funded that the funds get transferred. So there's some delay right there. Mine will be, it's almost as easy as click and send on an email.
Well, you know, as far as the fundraising for it with Kickstarter, I like Kickstarter. That's really kind of a cool thing. But like Leo said, it's not a store, and a lot of people look at it maybe like it is. Maybe it's their format, but I like it for what it is. Going back, you know, even for us here, we are in the process of doing a yearly fund drive, a fundraiser. Unlike any other fundraiser that we've done from before. And having said that, yeah, it's difficult, like Leo said, and I would agree with him, that maybe 2 or maybe 3% of your viewers or those that know about you will actually support what you're doing. The others are you know, saying, hey, leave it up to somebody else and count the flowers on the wall. So, you know, it is very difficult. I'm not saying that it is impossible, surely not. But, you know, even for us, yes. Hey, granted, I would love to have. And who was it? Somebody on Twitter had brought it up yesterday, and I caught wind of it. And I thought, you know, how funny. And they said, look, what would you give somebody over the holidays, you know, that has the DSLR camera? What would you give them for the holidays? And I said, the DSLR camera, right? You know, but having said that, yeah, it's difficult at best to get funding for anything. So how is it, and what is it that you're doing that has given you the funding so far that you have?
Well, so again, the funding so far came from my backers, and out of that 2,000 I mentioned, 280 have supported. So that's about 15% or 16%, which is pretty good. But the main aspect was the highlighting as many benefits to the backer as possible. So in the video, my video is actually a little bit more lengthy compared to most Kickstarter videos, about just under 6 minutes. And the whole time I'm showing benefit after benefit after benefit. So that's, I think that's been the biggest selling. It's the biggest thing that has driven my backers. Not to mention the fact that it's not just for iPhone. I've done that. This is a Samsung. I'm not sure which Samsung it is. They all look the same. But it fits a Samsung as well. It fits my iPhone 3GS, which I talked about before. So it fits a lot of different phones out there. And I'm not sure what the number is, but I guess it's right around a billion people have smartphones these days. It's going to get there in 2013. That's a pretty good market for me to focus at. And for 2,000 people only to see it out of that billion, then there's a lot of opportunity.
Well, what would you say? And Andrew, you can pipe in as well. As far as social media, and how people would be able, and both of your opinion, to use social media. Randy, you've got your invention, right? A good idea. Andrew, on the other hand, has got maybe nothing tangible of an idea like this, but he's got yet another idea. But how is it that you're able, that both of you would be able to use social media to be able to, A, get the word out, B, raise funds for it, and C, enrich your own life? Andrew.
I mean, one of the things, and I don't know if Randy's been in the group today, one of the things I posted to Randy was understanding which audience you're talking to and understanding how to speak to each audience. Because you could pitch the idea to one person and it'll sound great. You could pitch that idea to the same to another person the same way and it'll sound horrible. But you can pitch the idea to another person in a different way and they'll fall in love with it again.
Correct.
And I think that's the key thing, is to make sure that you're understanding what audience you're talking to at one time.
Correct. Randy, what has been your experience with it?
I completely agree, and what I've noticed so far is that I'm starting to see a little bit of a stall in my project. So the people that are already bought into it, they've bought into it already. The people that are kind of on the fence, those people that kind of see the benefits, but not too there. So what I've done is I went to I sent out messages to my current connectors, and a lot of the feedback was around the family. One really fun thing that I've seen is the use of it in golf, sport of golf. So I'm going I'm down in Petula, by the airport. They love this idea, and the reason they like it is because they can actually use it to coach their students playing golf. So students practice right in front of their tee box, and their swing that they can upgrade to their coach.
Randy, is there a way that you can get a little bit closer to your mic there?
Oh, yeah. How's this?
We'll see. You're fading in and out quite badly.
I wish I had a microphone like you do over there. I visited a couple of golf courses, and what they like about it, or what they like about the no amount, is to capture golf. As Andrew mentioned, I need to start zeroing in on those different markets and talk to them.
Well, I tell you, Randy, one of these days I would love to be able to have you on as a guest on the show and further get into not just this with what your invention, right? But we got to do something about your audio level. There is not much in the world that I can actually do with it. But it is always a pleasure, and I do want to thank you, Randy, for calling in using Skype. And hey, keep me as a Skype friend.
All right. Thanks for having me on the show, bro.
Yep, no problem. Thank you very, very much, Randy. All right, Andrew, what do you think? Not just about Randy's device and what he's doing, which hey, I do support it. I think it's great if any time that anybody is able to use their head, right? That's a good thing. But what, you know, in your own experience, Andrew, what has it been for you that has really enriched your life, challenged your life, et cetera?
In terms of social media?
Absolutely.
You know, the people I meet, I mean, that's how we met. That's how I've met a lot of people. That's how I met Randy. And I've met a lot of different people that have, you know, really helped me. I don't know, I guess, like I said, get from maybe starting to somewhere in the middle and eventually to the end of what I'm trying to do.
Well, you know, Andrew, I've got to hand it to you, though. As we have talked about a lot of things, most seriously, you know, I remember, Andrew, a lot of things that we've talked about. And, you know, I want to as well be able to go back over the video, today's show, with Leo Laporte. And, you know, yeah, I learned something from Leo. He's a snazzy kind of a guy.
He was at home, I could tell.
Yes, he was talking prior to going live. He said, "Well, I've just got to be very careful with the bandwidth." And I was like, "Oh my God, you're talking bandwidth!" You know, because he wasn't at the studio, his day off. But you know, looking at social media, social network, I think it's a great idea. The problem is getting people, and Randy, you can, I don't know so much that you can identify with what I'm saying, but I know, Andrew, you can, that getting people from a Facebook page, from a Twitter, and you put up an active real-life link, right, so anybody can click on it in a heartbeat minute and get them to start participating or get them active in what you're doing. A lot of times they'll sit back and say, "Oh, well, what's this? I'm scared to click a button. I'm scared to lend a hand. I'm scared to financially support something. I'm scared to join the Facebook or the Twitter." And you know, that's obnoxious. What do you think, Andrew?
Yeah, I mean, it's like Leo said. People just have to learn to not be afraid.
Well, you know, granted, I know that there's a lot of people that simply are very afraid of that. You know, folks, when it comes to us here, when we do a fundraiser, we did a fundraiser. You know, last year was the last one.
You can talk about it if you're avoiding mentioning it, but it was me. You can talk about it.
Well, it was a fundraiser, and. You know, we were slammed from hell and back, seriously, because of it. And then it dawned on me, wait a second, you know, we need to, you know, we need to do something here. Because for us just to stay live, and folks, all I'm believing for, and I have to have faith in, is money donations coming in to help us here with paying the freaking cable bill, because we had to actually upgrade our cable to a higher speed to be able to run the stream, this network, this media, in a more proficient way. And now, folks, we're looking at doing a podcast. We actually are. For those that are in the chat, we welcome you, ladies and gentlemen, and do, if you would like to chime in, choose a username on the your screen, and hey, it's simple, it's free, and there you can talk back and forth to us. But we're looking at doing a podcast. Andrew had brought it up to me, 5 months ago? And I was like, yeah, okay, Andrew. But the more and more that I've thought about it, the more and more that I've thought, you know, it may not be a bad idea. As yet another way for the verbiage to get out there. And Randy, it's like with what you're doing, even your inventions. It's the same thing. You've got to get the word out there somewhere. And Kickstarter, Leo, he's got some interesting things to say about Kickstarter. And one of them, which, hey, you heard it from him, it's not a store. Maybe, I don't know, use social media. Maybe that would be the next best thing, right, is to create a website that has inventions, that has products from independent people like yourself, for that matter, and sell these products outright on this website and make it into a store. Stuff that is not on seen on television, stuff that you will not find in a grocery store or in an outlet mall, and put all this stuff. Andrew, what do you think that could be possibly a good money-making venture? To do that?
Maybe. Although, and I know you've heard of it, Robin. I'm betting with Randy's way of thinking that he thinks, or at least that I think that he thinks. That's a lot of thinks in one sentence. You've seen Shark Tank, correct?
Oh, yes.
Could you imagine if there was a site where you invested in just that way, where you get a percentage of the company? And based on deals, and people were able to create legal binding deals as opposed to just throwing money at it.
Well, because sure. Well, I mean, if you think of it, and I don't know, maybe somebody will take the idea, this idea, and run with it and do something. But seriously, if you reinvent the wheel, please. Folks, that's exactly what I have, what I've said. When it comes to this media, when it comes to this show, I know that there's a lot of competition. I know there had been questions. Hey, are you guys in competition with the Occupy movement? The question is, or the answer is no. We never were, right? And as far as they go, I've got to reiterate it again. I'm not against them. I think that the original idea of that movement was fantastic. It was right on target. However, I as a person can say, yes, I support it. But we as a media, I've got to separate myself from that. The stream and what we do, we have to. Because otherwise we become biased towards them. And I don't want to be biased towards anybody. Because, folks, I'm always trying to push the envelope and trying to really get in there and see what on earth people are missing, especially when it comes to social media. So, Andrew, getting people to click, a mouse click, sometimes that alone is like pulling teeth and saying, you know what, I'm not going to do this because, oh, my goodness, if I push one more button, my keyboard is going to, or my mouse is going to break.
I think it's just, I mean, some people it's fear of social media. Some people it's fear that if they engage, they have to donate even if they can't, which is another thing. Like with Randy's Kickstarter project, I have to be honest and say, I've backed it to some capacity, so I have to just kind of put that out there. But, just because you can't back something doesn't mean that you can't share it and keep sharing it and keep sharing it. And in some ways, that's more valuable than one-time backing.
I agree. Now, as far as Randy goes, hey, Randy, this is an idea for you. When you are inventing things like this, hey, I think it's cool. It's and trust me, I'm sure that I can use it, right? And if I can find a use for something like this, granted, there are going to be hundreds of thousands, if not millions of others that could as well. It's that simple. Hey, you know what? I can even attach this to my computer monitor, right? Either one of them, or the camera. But the thing of it is, I would love to be able to, of course, to have you on, and for you to be even a supporter. And if you chose, once that you get your foot in the door a little bit more, Randy, and you wanted to become even a sponsor for the show, and let us put some of your stuff up if we have a special thing going on, and you say, okay, look, I'll donate, I'll give, you know, one of these or two or three or five of whatever to whoever does whatever to help us even here, it would get your product even into more hands. So hey, that's a challenge. You know, look, I always look for challenges, and Andrew, you know, and you've challenged me in a lot of ways. Let's see, Leo Laporte has invested in Usher's pillow for Gee Whiz show on his Twit network from Kickstarter. He's still waiting on it. You know, yeah, he did say something about Andrew, what do you think about that? This is yet, folks, we might go into overdrive a little bit today, end at the half-hour point, because there's a lot of very good interaction going on. Thank you very much. But what do you think about that statement in the chat?
The statement Leo made about...
No, a viewer says Leo Laporte has invested in Outreach Pillow. For Gee Whiz.
For Giz Whiz, got
Giz Whiz.
It.
Right, that's it. And he's still waiting on it.
Yeah, some projects just don't pull together, but it's, you know, the saying, you know, about risk and reward, right?
Absolutely.
It's kind of that sort of situation. And as long as you understand that, you're fine. Only take as much risk as you're comfortable with. If there's an option to invest $10,000 and you don't legitimately believe that your $10,000 is going to come back or you're going to get $10,000 in merchandise, so to speak, don't do it.
That's one thing, Andrew. Exactly. But when you're dealing and you're looking at something tangible, oh, here's another color of the same thing. But when you're dealing with a tangible object, right? That's one thing to sell the idea. But if you're looking at something that is non-tangible, you can't touch it. But you know that it's going to help. I.e., like, this stream and this program could use a DSLR camera, right? Or this stream could use a way better lighting configuration. Or hey, that stupid dummy on camera needs a makeup kit. Okay, hey, think of it. Okay, or if you're looking at something like, wait a second, there is the opportunity to be able to invest in someone's future, not necessarily into a group's future, but into a person. A lot of people, even with that, Andrew, they're like, you know, I don't want to invest. What's my return on the investment?
Well, I mean, there's the thing about Kickstarter is it is donation, but it's not donations, because you're 9 times out of 10 getting a product in return. So you're effectively donating in expectation of receiving a product in the future. So it's not really donation. Whereas situations like I think you're driving at, like with yours, is entirely donation, because it would never land on Kickstarter, because Kickstarter wouldn't know how.
Well, you know, I tell you, Andrew, even for us here, and I thought about it, you know, is to do a yearly fund drive, and that's it. And what it costs us yearly to stay on the air, you know what, at the present rate, that's what I'm basing it on. That's what it costs. But getting people to say, you know what, okay, I can invest. I can throw 20, 50, 100 bucks, you know, and I can do this, and be happy to do it. Rather than people that sit back and, you know, it's like any other invention, you know, hey, that's a good idea. Okay, well, where's the backing for it? Everything takes money. Everything takes a backer of some kind. And that's where Kickstarter does come in handy, because it matches the invention or the product with a backer. And that is the cool thing about it.
Yeah, I mean, it is. And I think one of the things Kickstarter is going to eventually have to implement specifically is some, if they haven't already, I didn't notice, but I've only invested in a couple of projects, and the couple that I've invested in, I've known the people on some level, i.e. Randy and another person, so I didn't bother to read all the terms and all that stuff. But I don't believe they make very good distinction on if you lose your money, you lose your money. And right. I think they need to make an effort to say, hey, this is a donation, or it's intended to possibly get you what you're going to get. And then they need to make that clear, or they need to figure out a way to hold people responsible for what they don't do.
Well, you know, I've seen some of the Kickstarter projects.
I know the one that Leo got, and it, I think he didn't mention it for a reason, so I won't either.
Well, you know, I've seen some of them. Some of them are interesting, nonetheless. This device, yes, interesting. Getting a patent for it, getting it out in the marketplace. From this to in the marketplace, that's completely a different story. I know that hey, the world's largest retailer, right? A lot of people like them, a lot of people hate them. But they're always looking for new inventions and new things to put on the shelf if the price is right. Hey, Andrew, I'm going to take a short break. If you want to mute your mic down, dear friend, I will be back right back with you. Right after this, folks, we are going to take a break. This is the Robert Christian Show, folks. We invite you right now, folks, to put it out on your Facebook, on your Twitter. Let your friends and neighbors
know. Hey, Rob, I actually have to go.
You're watching The Robert Christian Show. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Yeah.
All right, folks, Robert Christian Show, and we are back, folks, trying to make the best out of today, and I hope that everybody today is having a good day. Yeah. So, you know, folks, I think, and Andrew, I do want to thank you for your call, and Randy as well. You know, I'm hoping, folks, that people will decide that social media is not necessarily a bad thing. I'll tell you, when I use social media, I use the Facebook, RobertChristianShow.com, on my Facebook page, or Robert Christian Show, on Twitter, News Talk 2. And I use that as a way, folks, to get the word out about the show, about guests that are coming on, about ideas, at times questions. But in the real world, you know, I know, granted, I know that there's a lot of people that do use social media, but there's a lot of people that are totally against it. Now, some television stations, the PEG, the Public Access Educational and Government Channels, a lot of them have this idea that a call of action, like, okay, hey, you can call in right now at such and such phone number, or call in via your Skype. You can go to our website, yada yada, and find A, B, C, or D. A lot of them are completely against it, and they say no because that's a call of action. Whereas, folks, I enjoy a good call of action. I really do. I enjoy a challenge, and I enjoy people being able to say, you know, it's social media at its best. So how do you use it? As Leo said, and, you know, how excellent that was. You know what? There's no sense in being afraid of it. A lot of people are. They're you know, trust me. But, folks, when I use social media, I do it for two reasons. One, for personal, and second, for business. And trying to get people aroused, right? Excited and wanting to say, hey, you know what? I can be a part of this community. I can be a part of a interactive news talk show. I can be a part of it. I can support it financially. I can visit it. I can call in and be a guest on the show. Maybe you will be the guest. Maybe you'll be the next guest here on the show. Because you know what? As Andrew would tell you, and I've told everybody, you know, it's the people's mic. It's the people's voice. And I had no idea about Leo back in the day, prior to Tech TV, prior to the time that he started Twit TV or Twit.TV. But he was in apparently News Talk itself. So he and I, we understand this, that folks, going from television, that is not very interactive, right? In radio, not really interactive. Not unless that you're, you know, a guest actually in the studio or calling in. But this median, this thing that we have right now is truly a happy marriage. And I'd have to put it that way. It's a happy marriage, folks, between radio and television. Because at least here I can watch the chat in real time, see what's going on, see if people have questions. And sometimes the questions are very good. Sometimes the comments or the news links are of great interest. But folks, looking at social media and what we can actually do with it, I think that there is something, a missing link somewhere. And I want to be guilty in that, pressing the envelope to find out exactly what it is. What makes some fundraisers work and others fail? You know, there's one guy, one reporter, one journalist, and he prides himself, and he says, "Look, this is the whole kit and caboodle. Follow me on Twitter, follow me on Facebook, follow me. Do this, do that, do the other thing." And then I really wonder for what reason. Now, anytime that he goes on Twitter and says, "Hey, I went and used the bathroom. Hey, I got a cup of coffee," then suddenly he's got 10,000 likes in a heartbeat minute. But it's people like that that have the resource, the following, the community, that if he said, "Look, I need a round trip ticket on a Delta or Alaska Airlines or you know, I don't know, any of the other ones. Hey, I need an Amtrak ticket to wherever." Suddenly, bam, it's covered. If he said, "Look, you know, we need a DSLR camera, right, to go around and to broadcast from it." Okay, then bam, suddenly it's done. If he said, "Look, you know, hey, I'm hungry," then hey, you know, it's crazy. Maybe it's because of who he is. But when it comes to legitimate needs, right? Legitimate needs, like the fundraising that we did last year for a wheelchair. We did get enough money for it. Over about 11 or 12 hours or so plus, nonstop, we were on the air for it. And you know what? I would do it again. Because simply put, sometime, and I don't want to say it this way, but sometime it appears that you have to talk somebody into it. And you know what? I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm simply not. Everybody that watches the stream, everybody that has enjoyed the shows that we've done here, they know that, yeah, hey, this stream, I can help it. I can do something with it. I can encourage others to come and to participate. I can encourage others and be challenged. You know, look, I've even said, I've said it this way, even, because there's a lot of people. Some people have gotten very upset and have said, "Look, you know, I wish that there was more Occupy Wall Street stuff going on. I wish that the stream was live more, yada, yada, yada." But that's all fine and dandy. But getting the people, some of these people, even, to say, "You know what, I can be a procaster. I can go on live, you know, ask for the credential so you can go live and do that and to help us even that way." But, oh, heavens to Betsy, no. People, they just don't want to do it. And some do. But it's very few and far in between. So, folks, it is one thing to say, "Hey, I'm on Twitter." Well, what are you doing on Twitter unless you're really going to branch out and get out of the box and do something? What is good? What are you on Facebook for if you're not going to get out there, get the word out, get motivated, do what you need to do? A friend, David Bowers, he's on my Facebook page. He has apparently a syndicated radio show. I thank him because every time that I've asked him, "Hey, David, can you post something out?" Bam, it's up. You know, with Leo, granted, I know that even Leo Laporte has a lot of folks that are saying, "Hey, I'd like to do an interview with you." And but he took time out of his day off today, out of the studio, to be our guest and to be your guest in your own home, wherever that you are. If you're listening to this by chance of a podcast, he has taken the opportunity, really, to give some words of wisdom and some words of encouragement to continue on. Folks, there isn't a happy, equal verbiage or goal with with any other independent broadcaster or a podcaster. There simply isn't. Everybody has their own thing, and we have ours. I think, folks, that news, when we're talking about news talk, when you're talking about what is newsworthy, when you're talking about what is it that is going to get people together and bring people together, we should endorse that, no matter who that we are. You know, even Twit TV, I'm sure that even with Leo's show and his network, that it started off, I would imagine, small beans. In other words, very, very small amount of money to work with, and like we are. There are other streams that have the idea, and you know, hey, to some, yeah, it works. That they're not too worried about money. But you know, look, I've said, folks, and this is not a gimmick, it's not a ploy, but I've said this: unless that we are helped, we can't be expected really to be able to help other people and to help them to do what they need to do. There have been fundraisers in the past that we've done beyond a wheelchair. There was a young man this last summer that was denied graduating from high school. Folks, listen to this. He was denied graduating high school because he missed 2 days too many. And guess what? We got a hold of his story. And I got a hold of him. And we did a fundraiser for him and for his mother. No, it wasn't. We did not meet our goal, but we were at least able to do something. And beyond that, there were many calls, even from right here, to the school district, to the school board. And inevitably, the school board changed their mind and said, all right, he can graduate. Folks, I even contacted the local television affiliates there in Ohio where this young man is from. And they got a hold of the school board. And they, I mean, it was a story that was blown completely out of proportion. And at least I'm glad to say that we had something, right, to do with it. An Occupy Wall Street couple. Lost. Well, they moved out of their apartment. They gave away all of their worldly possessions in order to join the Occupy. And then we find that she, the girlfriend, was pregnant, and they needed a leg up. And what did we do here? I'm glad you ask. We did a fundraiser. So when people give to us here, it enables us, folks, to be able to give and to do something for someone else. And I'm not saying that we're it. No, obviously not. I know that there's a lot of much younger streams than what we are. But folks, looking, I mean, I've been in communications and radio and television for several years. But this is the happy marriage between radio and television. This is where I challenge every day social media. And I've seen it come to the rescue of others. And I'm hoping that one of these days, maybe it will come even to our rescue. That even here, it will be like, hey, you know, we can do something. Leo Laporte, of anyone, I think that who understands technology and who understands the challenge at hand, he does. But granted, when you are on a syndicated radio show, you know, in many markets around the United States, surely people are going to know you by your name. If you're on a local show, a local news show, a local PM magazine type show, then surely people in your market are going to know you. and they're going to support whatever that you do. But when it comes to social media, then what? People say, well, that's not necessarily my market. That's not necessarily where, it's not necessarily going to be what I really would prefer to watch or to participate in. So, folks, hands up. Did you guys actually learn something today from our guest, Leo? Let me know what you think. I did. And folks, another guest that soon, hopefully, that we are going to have. And I'll tell you this much, and I can tell you this much. Hey, so please pay attention. I'm working right now on yet another guest, up and coming. Right now, I'm waiting on a date. But everybody knows what True TV is on your cable networks. One of the upcoming guests is from one of the shows on True TV. And I have sent him emails. I've actually called his office already. I'm trying to anchor this thing down. And everybody will know what who he is once that he comes on live. And, would I be offended if there were three? No. Would I be surprised if there were 1,500? Yes. But, folks, when I have guests on, it has to be about them. It has to be about their story. It has to be about what they think, because it is their expertise that challenges everyone else and not me. Necessarily. Let's see. Oh, yes. Andrew, very, very funny, very comical. He says, yes, I learned that you owe me for the bet about podcasting. Speaking of, ladies and gentlemen, hey, if we were to do a podcast and put this show in that kind of a format, in a podcast format where you can go to iTunes, download the app, be able to listen to the shows or watch the shows on any portable device or even your home computer, would you do that? Again, it's getting people, just play like this is the mouse, okay? And so it's getting people to L clicko on the L mouse-o and say, yes, I'll download this. So would you guys do it? What do you all think of it? The idea of a podcast. Andrew and I, we have been talking about doing a podcast, yes. And about 5 months or so ago, he came up with the idea, the engraved idea. That, hey, maybe we ought to think about it. And I sat on it. I really did. But I had not been so challenged about it, about podcasting, as that I am now. So, folks, if you all like the show, you like shows like this one, then I encourage you to support it. I would encourage you folks to help us to get the word out. Use your Facebook. Use your Twitter. Let your friends and neighbors know that we are on the air, folks, when we are. Wow. So, folks, I am going to take a brief overture and take a look for a momento at some of the news headlines that are making its rounds. And I don't want to bore you because we are going to be getting back, folks, for just a few minutes. On social networking, social media. Apparently, Mitt Romney is planning on switching his debate strategy for tonight. Tonight is the third and final presidential debate here in the United States. What do you all think of that? According to a poll, the race is tied across the board. Of course, Mitt Romney is apparently gaining in the state of Florida. Ohio newspapers are now making their picks as to who is actually going to win the election. Wow. Activist Russell Means apparently has also passed away. There was another. Wow. iPod Mini is to be rolling out. And as I remember, Andrew, maybe I am forgetting, but I think that the iPod Mini is due out tomorrow in the marketplace. They say U.S. gas prices are also falling. Oh, good grief. Let's see. Five things to watch tonight in the presidential debate, if you are. Apple versus Samsung. Apparently, they have signed off on a peace treaty. That's kind of comical. Wow. There was a politician. Let me actually see if I can find this news story while I'm thinking about it, folks. Where is it? Well, you know, technology. Hey, technology is a good thing, but sometimes it just doesn't want to work that well, right? Anyway, hey, folks.